Hi everyone. In the last class, we started with some problems on first order RC circuits. So in this class, we will continue with the same problems, but I'll also add some initial conditions for the capacitors. So first, I just want to correct a few errors, the small errors that I made in the last lecture. So there were two problems where I made some small mistakes. So I'd given a circuit like this, and asked you to compute the, if I remember right, it is, I think I've given a step of 0 to Vx and asked you to find what is the voltage across the R and 2C in series. The whole problem is correct. So in the sense that we found out V of 0 and then V naught of infinity. And again, you can very easily show that V of 0 is a transient input. So capacitors, you can short it out. It will be Vx by 2 and V naught of infinity. Steady state, you'll have only capacitors, you'll be left with C and 2C, so you'd get Vx by 3. The mistake I made was in finding the time constant. So what I said was that, there is no conceptual mistake, but I just made a small careless mistake in the sense that I forgot, I just replaced 2C with C. So it's actually 2C. If I replace the capacitance by 2C, then the equivalent capacitance, this circuit will reduce to a simple R of value 2R, and the equivalent capacitance, they both are all are in series, it will reduce to 2 by 3C. So the time constant is actually 4R by 3C. Okay, so this is the time constant. In the last class, I accidentally wrote 2C as C. And then I got a different time constant, so that's the only correction. So your output will actually go from Vx by 2 to Vx by 3. So it just decays down, the time constant given by 4 by 3 RC. Okay, so that's all about this problem. And then there was one more a small error in an R to R ladder. I'd given Vx 2R while finding the Thevenin voltage, I just found the voltage at this point. I called it V1 and this is your final V0. I found the voltage V1, which was actually Vx by 3. I've assumed Vi. Let me just assume Vi instead of Vx. So V1 was Vi by 3. And so your V0 is actually V1 by 2, the open circuit voltage. So that will be Vi by 6. So the circuit will finally reduce to something like this. There will be a step of 0 to Vx by 6. And the equivalent resistance was the equivalent resistance for this circuit was you'd have 2R and 2R in parallel, that is R and R in series, and 2R and R in parallel. That will come out to be 2R by 3. So this is the final reduced circuit, and the step response will actually go from the final value, it will start from 0 and eventually reach Vx by 6 with the time constant tau given by RC by 9. Okay, that's the only change I wanted to make here. I'm sorry, the time constant here is actually it's 2R by 3 into C. So that's your time constant. So that's the only change I wanted to make. So we'll just continue with this today's lecture. So we'll again start solving problems on simple first order circuits. To show, especially in the last class, I stressed upon when you had two capacitors, how do you find the order is not 2 and 1? Okay, that was the problem we were solving in the last class. So I'll take a few more examples with two capacitors and show when the order will be 2 and when it is 1. So when you apply an input Vi here in this case, if you look at this two, there are two capacitors in this system, in this circuit. So the voltage is across one of the capacitors. So now what I'll do is I'll assume the voltage across the first capacitor is V1 and the second capacitor is V0. So we know that V1 plus V0 is Vi. See, Vi is a known input, it's a fixed input. Okay, so I'll assume Vi is, for example, a step input, or it's a constant input, some constant input. So if you see, there is a linear relationship between V1 and V0, which are essentially the voltages across both the capacitors. So when you have a linear relationship, what does it mean is that if I know V1, then V0 is fixed. V0 is automatically known. And similarly, if I find V0, V1 is also automatically known. So there is only one independent variable which needs to be found. Okay? So therefore, this reduces the order. So even if there were two different, usually what happens in two capacitor circuits is that you have two variables across the voltages, two voltage variables across the two capacitors, and both the voltage variables cannot be expressed as a linear function, with a linear dependence. So I took an example yesterday and showed that if you take an RC and an RC, V1 and V2, they had a relationship, but it's not a simple linear equation like this. Okay, so if you see your dV2 by dt into RC plus V2 equals V1. So this is not a linear relationship, but there is some kind of a differential, a first order relationship between V1 and V2. So even though you know V1, you'll have to again integrate V1 to find the value of V2. Okay, whereas that is not the case here. It's just proportional. There is a direct linear relationship between V1 and V0. Okay, so once you know V1, then automatically V0 is also known. So that's how you know that a system is a first order. When you have a two capacitor circuit, it'll be a first order circuit if there is a linear equation relating both the capacitors. So then I took another example, let's call it R1, C1, R2, C2. Again, in this circuit, if you see, the voltages, the currents in both the capacitors are same. So I can simply equate the current in all both the capacitors are same. I can simply assume the voltage across this capacitor as V1 and voltage across this as V2. Then you know C1 dV1 by dt should be equal to C2 dV2 by dt. So if I integrate on both the sides, I'll actually get C1 V1 equals C2 V2 plus some constant of integration. Okay, some k. K is the constant of integration. So again, if you see, there is a linear relationship between the voltages V1 and V2. So when you have a linear relationship between the voltages V1 and V2, then the order of the system can be reduced. You know, and since there is also resistors in the system, the maximum order can be only one. So that's something to keep in mind. So we'll now solve this problem. R, C and C. And we're going to apply a step input of value 0 to Vx. So again, all you need to do is find V0. So we know the system is a first order system because there is a linear relationship between the voltages across both the capacitors. Okay, the currents in both the capacitors are not same, but there is a linear relationship between both the capacitor voltages. Okay, the current being same ensures a linear relationship between the voltages of the capacitors. Okay, so in this circuit, if you see, the currents need not be the same. In this circuit, it turns out it's not the same. You know, the currents are not the same, but the voltages are linearly related. So as soon as I give you a step, from that you know that okay, it's a first order system. So then you need to find V0 of 0, V0 of infinity, and the time constant. Okay, so we'll find V0 of 0. The instant you switch the input on, so I said your capacitive impedance is very low. So whenever you have anything in parallel with a low impedance, it's just the low impedance itself. So I can ignore the resistance. So the moment you give an input of 0 to Vx, the output is going to be half a volt. So V0 of 0 is going to be Vx by 2, half of Vx. Now, the next goal is to find V0 of infinity, which is your steady state input. When your input is in steady state, it's unchanging. Your capacitors behave like open circuits. So the resistor is present as it is. Capacitor, I can just open that node and show it like this. So now if you see the current flowing through this, because it's in series with the voltage source, the input voltage source, this voltage is at Vx volts, the current is zero. Okay? Since the current is zero, the current flowing through resistor is also zero. So from that you can say that the voltage across the resistor is also zero. So V0 of infinity is again zero. So you know the initial voltage, final voltage, the only thing remaining is time constant. again it's a single resistor circuit. Again, I said, you know, even if you ignore the fact that the voltages are, you know, linearly related, you can still say that there is only one resistor in the circuit, so the circuit can still be a first order system. So now, if you actually find the time constant, the effective capacitance seen by the resistance is 2C, because if you short the input, both the capacitors will come in parallel, so your time constant will be 2RC. I'm not doing this in detail because I've solved time constants in the last class, so you can apply a similar procedure. So you will get time constant as 2RC. You start at Vx by 2, which is a V0 of 0, and go to 0 eventually with the time constant of 2RC. Okay. So the mathematical expression for this will be Vx by 2 into e power minus t upon 2RC into u of t. So by now you should know how to write mathematical equations given the transient, for a first order system at least, given the transient waveform. Okay. So now in a similar way, we'll consider another problem, which is, so we have R1 C1, R2 C2. Now in this problem, there are two capacitors and two resistors, and also the currents through both the capacitors are not the same. Okay, they need not be the same. But again, we can write a linear relationship between the voltages across both the capacitors. If V1 is the voltage across this capacitor, so then I can write Vx equals V1 plus V0. Since there is a linear relationship between both the capacitor voltages, again the order of the system, okay, if you see the real number of independent variables in the system is just one. V0 is the only one independent variable, okay, because if you know V0, you already know the input variable Vi, or you know Vx in this case, so you already know the voltage across the capacitors, both the capacitor voltages are known, okay, so there is only one independent variable. Generally the order of the system, if it's only a single variable that needs to be found, so single independent node, or you know the variable across the capacitor which you need to find, then it usually is a first order system. Okay, so this is other way of checking whether it's a first order or not. So now, since I've decided it's a first order system, now how do we go about analyzing the circuit? The instant the step is applied, the instant the voltage goes from 0 to Vx, what happens is that the capacitors, both the capacitors offer very low impedance. So I can ignore the resistors, and then the circuit simply reduces to two capacitors. Okay, since both the capacitors are in parallel with the resistor impedance doesn't matter. You know, it's very large in comparison to the capacitive impedances. The capacitive impedance is so small that it shunts out the resistors. You know, when I say shunt, it just completely bypasses the resistors. So now the voltage across the output V0 of 0 is actually C1 by C1 plus C2 into Vx. Okay. Now similarly, we'll find the steady state responses. In the steady state, both the capacitors behave like open circuits. So I can ignore the capacitors because they both are in parallel with the resistor. The open impedance is high, the resistive impedance is much lower in comparison. So the parallel equivalent is always lower than the lowest. And in this case, it will be just the resistors itself, because the parallel impedance is infinity. The other capacitive impedances are infinity. So the parallel values will be just the resistive values itself, which is R1 and R2. So now when I give a final steady state voltage is actually Vx, what happens is that the voltage, both the currents are same in the steady state across both the resistors. So your V0 of infinity is R2 by R1 plus R2 into Vx. Okay. Now we know this is a first order system, the only thing remaining is to find the time constant. So just short the input. When you short the input, you are left with R1 C1, make the input go to 0, and R2 C2. So club the resistors and capacitors together and find the effective time constant. So that will be R1 parallel R2 into C1 plus C2. That will be your time constant. Okay. Again, there is a frequency domain approach of finding the time constants that we will cover it in the coming classes. Now you can take it as effective time constant, you sum of the capacitors and find the net resistance seen by the capacitors. Okay. Yeah. So I can combine both the resistors into a single resistor, and I can find the equivalent capacitance seen by the combined resistor. you will get the same result shown here. So now the graph, we'll start drawing the time domain graph. So if you see, at t equal to 0, the value is actually c1 by c1 plus c2. At t equal to infinity, it's actually r2 by r1 plus r2. Now there are three possibilities for these values. I mean, you can actually have c1 by c2, so you can have r2 by r1 plus r2 greater than c1 by c1 plus c2. So I've shown it in this graph. In this case, it is greater. It can also be lower than c1 plus c2. The value can be r2 by r1 plus r2 can be lower than c1 by c1 plus c2. Okay. Or the third condition, it can also be equal. We will come to that equal condition later. Now, if it is higher, we know that it's going to rise asymptotically like a first order system and reach this. If it is lower, it's going to decay down exponentially. Okay. With both the cases, the time constant is given here. The time constant is the value that's given here. Okay. Now, the third case is when it's equal. When it's equal, the output will just remain constant. Okay, because the final and initial value are the same, it's a first order system, so the output will just remain constant. Okay, so that condition, when your output is equal, is of interest, and we can see when does it happen. So you're left with C2, R2 by R1 plus R2 as C1 by C1 plus C2. Now you just rearrange the terms. So this can also be written as 1 plus C2 by C1 equals 1 plus R1 by R2. So you will be left with the condition 1 and 1 goes away. You will be left with R1 C1 or C1 R1 equals C2 R2. Okay. So if this condition is met, then the transfer function is just half. When C1, because in that case you can actually show C1 R1 equals C2 R2, the transfer function also reduces to half. So you can actually the transfer function need not be half. It'll still depend upon the ratio of the resistors. Okay, as long as you satisfy this condition, C1 R1 equals C2 R2, the final values and the initial values are same, so you will suddenly have a step at the output too. Okay, it will not behave like a first order system. The first order system has a finite time to catch up with the input, or you know, a reduced version of the input. But in this case, when R1 C1 equals R2 C2, you will actually have a step output as well. And the value of the output will be determined by R2 by R1 plus R2, which is also equal to C1 by C1 plus C2. That's it. So we have now discussed extensively about RC circuits with zero initial conditions. And we also discussed in detail about how to find time constants from time domain, and also whenever you are given, see, these are all first order systems, so at max you can have two resistors and two capacitors. Okay, I'm comparing the number. It can be, if it's a purely capacitive circuit and just one resistor, it is still a first order system. I'm talking about a system wherein the voltages need not have a linear dependence. Okay, so the maximum order, what I discussed is that if I had two capacitors, the maximum order will be two. If they have a linear relationship, both the voltages across the capacitors can be expressed as a linear function as a simple linear equation, then the order will be one. So normally the maximum order, when you have two capacitors, the maximum order is two. So we have actually solved a bunch of problems. I think now I'll discuss about RC circuits with initial conditions.